Welcome, everybody. Thank you for joining us today on the Friday of Reconciliation Week. We had lots happening all week long, and we will be able to share some of the videos through our partner, the Lethbridge Public Library, afterwards. Today, there's a lot happening. There's this talk right now, and then at 11 a.m., our partner Alpha House has a memorial. They also have a community cleanup first thing tomorrow morning at 9 a.m., followed by a barbecue. Also today is the bannock-making contest at the Interfaith Food Bank. If you're interested in joining that virtually, you can check out them on Facebook. I think that's it for today. We have the contests, the art contests happening. They are through United Way. Also, if you're a student or alumni of the University of Lethbridge, they have an art contest as well. We have the orange shirts, limited quantity available. I only ordered adult sizes. The small and medium went super fast. So I think there's only larger sizes available now through, and the Lethbridge Public Library is helping us with distribution. Okay, so I'm excited. We have our Métis elder with us today. She's also a member of the Reconciliation Lethbridge Advisory Committee at the City of Lethbridge, which has brought you this week of Reconciliation Week. And I am going to turn it over to Louise Salaf, who will also be starting us off with a blessing this morning. Good morning, Louise.
Good morning, Pam. Thank you for having us. And behind me, you'll see one of my dearest friend sisters, Elizabeth, who is going to assist me this morning. And I apologize for not being able to see me more. I'm so short. It doesn't matter what we do. I'm kind of like the princess and the pea. You never really get to see my full face. So, you know, but I'm here. So I think what we'll do is, do you want me to start off with smudge in the prayer, Pam? Okay. So I'm going to welcome and invite all of you. We're doing a virtual smudge this morning. It's unfortunate one day soon we will all gather together and be able to do it face to face, but this is different times, so we're doing it the best way that we possibly can, because it is such an important part of our culture that we need to do this. When you smudge, you always smudge towards the east where the sun rises, and it's used as a cleansing so that we're performing a blessing. We're sending our requests out into the universe, to Mother Earth, to God, to whoever you believe in. And we're calling on all the strengths of our ancestors to help us, to guide us, to help us to have positive energy so that we can work within with each other and also with others to make this a better world. And we realize that, you know, we need to stay humble and we do recognize that we are always in need of advice and guidance. No matter how much we've learned, we can always use just a little bit more nurturing. And so we are going to be asking the universe to embrace us and to guide us and to help us, especially in these troubled times. So if you would like to, we're sending you the virtual smudge as we do the prayer. And we are going to be doing a prayer. Is going to be done in Mi'kmaq. Now, I don't speak Mi'kmaq. I do apologize for that. But I'm going to say it in the English translation. So, Pam, if you could put up the Mi'kmaq prayer, and then I don't know how we would share the screen so that they can see, and then I'll just read the English part. And just remember that, we don't have it. Okay. Well, that's okay. I'll just, there we go. I've learned a lot from being on Blackfoot territory and being welcomed in as a Métis, because I do acknowledge that this is the Métis, not the Métis, sorry, this is Blackfoot territory that I'm residing on, and I do acknowledge that, and I'm very thankful as a Métis woman and an elder to be so embraced by the Blackfoot community that I have been, and I do thank them. And one of the elders that I have learnt a lot from, Elder Peter, always says, told me that however we pray, whoever you pray to, whatever you believe in, we're all basically praying to the same God, the same creator. So, you know, if you have a different way of praying, then please, by all means, do that. So I'm going to do our prayer, the Midshift prayer, when we come together. God, our creator, give us courage. Let us be of one mind. Make us righteous, thankful, and proud. Help the Métis to work together, especially utilizing our elders as teachers and preparing our youth for the future. Lord, provide us with direction and inspiration as we build a road for the Métis Nation in this country. We must have strong Métis families in order to have a strong Métis Nation. So we've I think on that note, I think Elizabeth is going to just talk a little bit about who I am. So, Elizabeth?
Absolutely. Happily. So I have known Louise for 30 years, and she is one of the most gracious and community-driven people I've ever met. Lethbridge is her home, and it is her career, and it's where she's raised her family, and she's been such a part of children, youth, and families with children's services for 38 years. Louise got here in 1979, and she crossed many provinces to get here, but made this her home right away. Louise enjoyed her work and got in the fields of psychology, drama therapy, went to the University of Lethbridge and got her degree. She has been an active member of the Lethbridge community, becoming involved in Aboriginal Housing Society Board, Urban Aboriginal Council of Lethbridge, Sisters in Spirit, which is dedicated to the murdering and missing Aboriginal women, as well as become the Vice President of the Métis Nation, Alberta Local.
Not now.
At this time, she is an elder at the Lethbridge College and continues to work and mentor students as a place of kindness and information and warm guidance. Louise has also been awarded several significant awards. One was for her contribution to domestic violence prevention, and that was the Jerry P. Selinger Award in 2003. She was nominated for the Human Services Worker Award for the Opiskani Aboriginal Early Intervention Society in 2007, and she was awarded the Community Council Leadership Award through the Aboriginal Council of Lethbridge in 2012. Louise has worked with in every facet of children's services, where it's child and youth care, whether it's families, whether it's domestic violence, whether it's new immigrants. She has championed and seen where there are services that are missing and done everything she can to rally support, bring groups together across the board, and collaborate in some of the most exquisite partnerships that have ever been created here in the city. Louise loves very much and is very connected to honoring the First Nations people, to honoring all human beings that have come here and can appreciate the safety and the kindness and the warmth of this community. So I would just like to say that that knowing her for as long as I have, she is an incredible gift. She has so much to share, such wonderful stories to tell, and I cannot wait to hear what she's going to share with us today.
Well, thank you, Elizabeth. That she sounds like a nice lady.
I know, right?
Well, first of all, what I thought I would do this morning is I just wanted to clarify. I know that at times before I start, I want to just explain a little bit about who the Métis are, because I know that sometimes there's just a little bit of confusion as to who they are and where they have come from. It's not all the Red River settlement. The Métis, the first Métis were the children of European fishermen and First Nations women along the Atlantic coast of Canada. And that was in Acadia. And so that's how they came to be. And the French authorities, some of them didn't approve of these unions. The church was, I guess, a little concerned that the men would prefer the freedom of life in Canada, and which was Turtle Island at the time. And the Métis children often stayed with their Indigenous mothers or were raised in French society. So the Métis population at that time was farther inland. The fur traders and the soldiers settled around the tiny forts and fur trade posts. And these communities form many of the basis of future cities and towns in Canada, such as Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario, and then in the States, there was Detroit, Michigan, Chicago, and Illinois. And then in the Western Métis, which is where I'm from, it was a different group of Métis that emerged in Western Canada. And we are the sons and daughters of the fur traders and the Indigenous women. Most were French and Catholic, although some had English-speaking Protestant fathers. The Hudson Bay Company frowned on these marriages at first. But the Northwest Company encouraged these unions. And it was felt that the reason that they encouraged them, and I will share a little bit more about that later on, is that they felt that if you were coming into a strange land, and this, we have to agree, this was a very harsh, strange climate to live in, to survive through the winter, if you didn't know how to survive on the land, because there were no Hilton hotels, there was no wonderful restaurants to go to. This was it. And so what better way to survive the winter and learn the skills that you needed to learn than to marry an Indigenous woman and hopefully be welcomed by her family so that you could learn these skills. And so soon the Métis formed their own culture, combining both the European and the First Nations elements. And in my line, I have got Cree, Crow, and Sioux, and that's on my mother's side. And then my father's side, I'm just exploring because we have just found that he had some First Nations women in his line. And I also wanted to just say too, that when I first started finding out who I was, because I didn't grow up to know that I was Métis. I guess I'll just shoot into this right now, is that when I was a child, we were never told who we were. It was just a little, there was so much shame and discrimination, racism on being Métis, to be a half-breed, to be, you weren't really wanted in the one world and you weren't really wanted in the other. So a lot of people had a lot of difficulty, and that's why I believe the Métis communities became so strong within them, because they were united front. They really didn't feel belonging, that they belonged in the one side or the other side. So they were basically, in a sense, the new settlers within Canada. I mean, we know that the Indigenous population, First Nations, have been here, it's timeless, and we do recognize that. And then the Métis. So I'm going to, on that note, ask Pam if she could just kind of show the documentary. And what you're going to see here is a story about my grandfather, Andre Gaudry, and my grandmother, we'll talk about them after this is played. So okay. In my family, we were talking before we were born. I'm a true Gaudry clan. I am Louise Marie Saloff. My clan is the Gaudry clan. That's the clan that I'm going to speak of today. And my father's name is Howell, so I'm Louise Marie Gaudry Howell Saloff. And
Craft. I was born in Saskatchewan. My great-grandfather, Andre Gaudry, came from the Red River settlement in Manitoba. There was a big fire around Wood Mountain in southern Saskatchewan. And as a result of that, the buffalo were scarce. Our people were starving. So my great-great-grandfather, Andre Gaudry, was scouting out some places which would be good for the Gaudry clan. So when he found willow bunch, it was because there was just an abundance of willows. And you know, willow is very sacred. Because it was so abundant and it was a valley and it had a lot of the different herbs and sage and the willow and animals and then you had your water and you had fish. And so he asked his good friend, Jean-Louis Laguerre, to help bring his clan out to Willow Bunch. And there was about six of them that were the founding fathers of Willow Bunch. And my great-great-grandfather was one of them. So then from my great-great-grandfather, Andre, down the line, I have Cree, Crow, and Sioux. And when my mom and my aunties and my grandmother and whatever would get together, they would be speaking a combination of French and Mi'kmaq. So we knew that, you know, we had something else in us, but nobody really ever talked about it. My grandma, when she was in residential school, she lost her whole family. It was gone. When she got out of residential school, she never saw her family again. Can you imagine being put in residential school when you're just a little girl and you come out when you're 14 or 15 or whatever and you get married and you've lost your family, never to be seen again? My dad and my mom, they both died when I was fairly young. So then I didn't know who I was because it was kept hidden because there was so much shame, there was so much racism, there was so much discrimination. So it was really tough for people. So it was easier to kind of hide who you were and assimilate wherever you could, the best that you could. It wasn't until about 10 years ago that my brothers and I thought, hey, why don't we find out who we are? When I got to Willow Bunch, I found out I was related to half the town. You know, when you come in and you're gassing up and they ask you where you are and who are you from. And 2 hours later, when we got to the coffee shop, I had two cousins sitting there waiting for us. They came over and introduced themselves to us, and the rest is history. I think when I found out that I was Métis, it finally gave me that sense of belonging, that sense of identity that every child needs. It's been a real healing journey for me to finally know who I am. My big wish, sharing my story, is that I'm giving back to my ancestors. I'm giving back to my grandmother. I'm giving back to what was lost so that our story can be shared and told, so that my grandchildren, my great-grandchildren, and on will know our story. One time I read a story about Mother Earth. The reason that women wore dresses was that so that when you walked on the ground, Mother Earth knew that you were female, because women give birth. And so Mother Earth could bless you and just help you to find some inner peace and guidance. I've never forgotten that. To be out there with Mother Earth and the Creator, it calms. I will read you just the first verse of the Métis anthem that has come out. In the forest, on the river, and across the western plain, as the white man journeyed westward to the land of the Indian, a new race was created, a new nation rose up strong, hardship as its destiny and its curse to not belong. In the land from which they came, in the land they helped to build, they found themselves the alien, found their vision unfulfilled. And despite their valiant effort to defend what they believe, when at last the battle ended, they were only left to grieve. We are proud to be Métis, watch our nation rise again. Never more forgotten people, we're the true Canadian.
All right, and then on that note, Pam, can you put the next slide on? All right, as you can see, my journey is hiding in plain sight as a young Métis woman learning who my ancestors were. And you'll see a picture there. These pictures, when I was in Willabunch in southern Saskatchewan, we went to the museum, and in the museum there was a display on my grandfather André Gaudry and Laguerre, the gentleman with the beard on the right side, and Sitting Bull. There is a replica of the Red River cart and of a small teepee. And so that was just a fascinating day of starting to learn who I was. And the ladies in the museum were just wonderful. They gave me copies of the pictures. And I have to tell you a story about the pictures as well, because I'll tell you, we are really 6 degrees from separation. These three pictures were taken. I'm sure.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to day two of the 2020 SOFA Summit. Mark Hart and Sean Taggy here, for those of you that are just chiming.
So where did that come from? Oh, anyway, sorry about that.
Louise, sorry about that. That was my background. Oh,
I was wondering, like, what did I do? But I pushed something.
That anyway, was fine.
No, that's all right. I was wondering what I did. No, that's good. But these three pictures, it really shows you that 6 degrees of separation, of how we're all kind of interconnected. I feel that, you know, we are all connected. I'm sure a lot of you know Marcia Blackwater from the college and from you know, around the area. And her husband's relatives, I believe it was I could be wrong, but one of his relatives, I'm not sure if it was his grandfather, who it was, he was with the RCMP North, and he was the photographer. And so when he went to Willabunch, he was commissioned to take pictures of Sitting Bull, Laguerre, and my grandfather, André Gaudry. And so he took these pictures. And when I brought them out to the college one day, just to show I was doing something out there, and Marcia looked at them and she said, "I know who took those pictures." Now, isn't that a small world? You know, it really is, truly is. So, and my grandfather spoke 5 languages. He spoke Michif, Cree, Crow, Sioux, French, and English. I think that was 5 or 6, I don't know. Anyway, and he was used as an interpreter and a guide by the Northwest Mounted Police, and he was very instrumental. He did a lot of work within the community. He was a carpenter. He accompanied Sitting Bull back to Fort Buford. He was one of the main people that when they had the big fire at Wood Mountain and the buffalo were scarce and people were starving, that he scouted out Willabunch, and which was a beautiful area. But all of that is another story, because for those of you who know me, I could talk on for hours and hours and hours, and I don't want to get sidetracked on this today. But I do have a lot of stories to share, and you know, there are stories that I have been told. And a lot of these stories, when I did go to Willabunch, I have been very blessed in the fact that there are relatives there, that the stories were told to them. So these are stories that have been handed down. And so I've been very fortunate in that sense. And then also a lot of these stories that I have read about my grandfather and new ones that I've since learned, I have found in different books. So when you're reading a book on the history of what's happened and transpired over the years, and then I find a story about my grandfather or one of my other relatives, it's like being a kid in a candy store. It's like, wow, another story. It's amazing. So it's just a journey that I've been on, and it's been wonderful. And I wished I would have known this earlier in my life, but we can go on to the next slide, Pam. This is me, of course, and this is a dear friend of mine, Rosemarie Clam, and I want to pay recognition to her. her husband is Métis, but his job always took him where he was away and he wasn't available to help. And Rosemarie just kind of became a stand-in for him and helped us with a lot of activities and celebrations and what have you in the Métis community here within Southern Alberta. And so I just wanted to give recognition, and her children have gone on to school, and she's just been a wonderful asset for us. So we can turn the slide. And again, there we go. And Andrea spoke up, so we could turn the slide again. And then here he is. This is part of the display in Willabunch with the Northwest. This tells about the Northwest resistance. This is another story with Bataj that, you know, is for another day, because it is quite a story. But the Northwest Mounted Police asked my grandfather, and I call him my grandfather, even though he was, you know, great and whatever, to take some of his band of brothers and go up to Bataj to find out what was going on with the resistance, to see, you know, what could they do to maybe settle things. So him and his band of brothers went up to Bataj, and when they were up there and they found out what was going on, they joined the resistance. And not just joined the resistance, but they became real staunch supporters of Louis Riel, to the point, and this is another story too, of my grandfather Andre had racehorses, and they were going to take his prize racehorse when Louis Riel was in Regina in jail waiting to be hung. And they devised a plan to take the racehorse up there to help him escape from jail and to send him off to the States. And of course that didn't happen, because we know what happened. So that's another story for another time. But we can go on to another slide. And as I said before, with Chief Sitting Bull, when he came to the Willabunch area, my grandfather, you know, he brought, there was at that time about 300 of his people that came with him. And they settled around the Willabunch area, and he got to be good friends with Jean-Louis and my grandfather. And another story is that when the Great White Mother, Queen Victoria, was trying to help solve the resistance and what have you, Jean-Louis did not know how to speak the different languages. So my grandfather was the interpreter. And so that's another story, but there was some real rich history in Southern Alberta, Southern Alberta, Southern Saskatchewan, where I'm from. And yes, so we can go to the next slide. And then this is, of course, is just a bigger picture of the teepee and the Red River cart. And we can flip to another slide. And then I received this, these pictures from one of our Métis elders up north, and it's a display on Louis Riel, and they have this in the Manitoba area. And I wanted to show this today because, you know, he was such an amazing man, and, you know, he was a real strong advocate, and he fought for the Métis, and he fought for the rights, and he was just a wonderful man, and it's unfortunate that things happened the way that they did. So there's a lot more stories about him that I could share, but I won't today. So we could go to the next slide. Okay, this is my father. Okay, I'm just going to spend a few minutes and talk about him. This is my father, and I wrote Gilbert Howell. He was a Métis in the Navy in World War II, but he didn't know he was Métis. I don't know if he ever knew. And this was when Queen Elizabeth was in Regina in 1952. And I'm not sure if she was the queen then or just still the princess, but that's John Diefenbaker beside her. And my father was in the honor guard. And that's quite a tribute to him, because my father's story is quite tragic and sad. When he was a young boy, he was about five, his mother died in childbirth. and he had six other brothers and a sister. And the sister and her husband tried to take care of the boys, and then she died in childbirth. So when that happened, the brother-in-law took the boys, and they took them around to different farm areas around northern Saskatchewan to see if anybody would take in, you know, one or two or whatever. And my dad ended up being on a farm, and it wasn't the most pleasant. And he had a few places that he was shuffled around here and there and whatever. And it wasn't until he was about 11 or 12 that he did get into a wonderful family. They were a German family. They treated him beautifully, but by then I think the scars had got to him by just, you know, whatever he had suffered in his life by being this little, you know, child that didn't know who he was, and this little half-breed boy that was shuffled from farm to farm and had to work for his dinner. So anyway, when the Second World War came, he joined the Navy, and then after the war, it was he was able to reconnect with his brothers, which was, and that's how he met my mother during the war. He was on a minesweeper. He was on minesweepers and submarines, and he was on a minesweeper during the war. There was a battle just off the coast of Nova Scotia, and his minesweeper was torpedoed, and he was injured. So he was taken to the hospital in Halifax, and that's where he met my mother. And I'm going to do a little like humor, because the Métis are very humorous, and we don't want people to be so feeling down, because these are hard stories to hear sometimes. And but when afterwards, you know, my dad had quite the sense of humor, and my mother was just this wonderful, naive little girl. And people would say, "Oh, Gil, where did you meet Doris?" And he would say, "Oh, I met her in bed during the war." And, you know, you can smile because, you know, when she got older, she just like poo-pooed him. But at the beginning, it was, you know, she was kind of embarrassed. She was the army nurse that was he was her patient. So on that note, we can flip to the next slide. And that's a picture of my mom and dad when they got married. And she was still in the army at that time. And she got out shortly after. And she was pregnant with my oldest brother. So we can do the next slide. And that's a picture of my mother when she was in the army. And she was just a beautiful, wonderful woman. And she didn't have an easy life when she was young, you know, her mom and dad, and there was 12 kids, and there was a lot of discrimination, and, you know, it just wasn't that easy of a life for them. But they persevered, and, you know, what happened after, and why they became so hidden and didn't, and we were kind of hiding in plain view, kind of goes to the treatment, because there has been so much discrimination and what have you. But here's this beautiful Métis woman that was in the Second World War fighting for our freedom. And I think that says a lot for the strength of the women in my family. So we can go to the next slide. And then this is some of our, we've been very blessed with some of the Blackfoot dancers that we have in the community. And I've just been fortunate enough to know some of them. And if you know the Métis community, we love to eat and we love to have fun and dance and sing. And we are all inclusive. Everyone is welcome to attend and have fun and enjoy. And this was a feast that we had during Louis Riel week. And then I also want to say too that, you know, I've been fortunate enough to get to know a lot of the First Nations youth, and I had the pleasure a few years ago of being the field instructor supervisor for six of the first Indigenous Bachelor of Social Work students from the Red Crow College. So I learned a lot. I'm very thankful for that. So yeah, we can go to the next slide. And then before we go on, I just want to say with my students, I think I learned more from them than they did from me, because they shared a lot of the knowledge about the culture and customs and ceremony, and that was really good for me to know and to get a better understanding. So I thank them for that. Now this, I was in a school in Calgary, and I was teaching the Trails of My Ancestors at a grade 9 French immersion class. And I was telling them how to build a soddy, which is basically a dirt house. And I don't know how many of you have ever heard about a soddy, but I can pretty well tell you how to make one. But if you know me, I don't imagine you could see me digging in the dirt to get the squares of the soddy to, you know, to do the mud and make the mud. They're like a mud type hut. And for those of you who are familiar with the Hobbit movies and whatever, you've seen the little houses they live in. Well, that's typically what a soddy kind of looks like. And, you know, you would have this little soddy, and then you would have the mom and dad and kids all living in this one big room with the stove at one end with the chimney going out. And then you would always have to make sure that your window was away from where the wind blew. And, you know, you had to keep that mud on it to keep the wind blowing out. And they usually dug them down about 4 inches, 6 inches into below the ground, just to, so that wind wouldn't go through. And the kids were just, there was a really good school. It was one of the best schools that I did a present. I think there was 90 of them in there. And they were really helpful. It was a really good day. And they had fun. And when I explained to them that, you know, you slept and you ate and you're soddy. And they had to, you know, when you go out and you're in the middle of the wilds. And, you know, Southern Saskatchewan at that time, it was the Wild West, and you had to have shelter from the animals and what have you, so and the elements. So it was quite an interesting day, and they were very responsive. So just wanted to share them as well. So you can do the next slide too. And then here we are, and I had some pictures up, and there's my picture of my granddaughter Grace, and then these are some of the students in the class. And I took up some capote coats that I have, and they had fun trying them on. So that took a little bit of time, but they all seemed to really love them. They would be a very warm, snuggly coat if you were caught in a winter storm. So we can do a next slide. And then the Métis sash, I'm sure all of you are familiar with that. There was many uses for it. And if you have any questions on it, you can certainly ask me, and then we'll go to the next slide. Okay, now we're going to start talking about my story. I just wanted to share with you, you know, I've been very fortunate in my life. I think I'm this forever optimist, this, you know, eternal, things will always get better, always. When I was a small child, and after the war, my mom and dad, we lived in wartime houses in Regina. and it was a harsh time. You know, I ended up with 7 brothers and myself and my mom and dad, and we had just a small house. And at that time, after the war, times were tough. And my dad worked really hard. My mom stayed home. And, you know, but things were tough, and things were getting a little bit scary in Regina at the time. There was the racism and discrimination was reaching levels that I don't know. It was not a good time. I know that we were, my family and I, my brothers and I, were the product of a lot of bullying. I remember we went to a Catholic school because my family was raised Catholic. And there was a public school that was half a block away that would have been so much more suitable. But we had to walk, and it was about 8 to 10 blocks, summer, winter, fall, and in Regina. And I remember coming home, and maybe I wasn't too bright when I was a kid, I don't know, but there was this one, I always had this one path of the way that I would go home. And there was a girl there that if she was home, when I was going by, she would come out and she wouldn't let me cross, you know, get past her. And she heckled me and she'd throw my books down. And she was just not very nice to me. And I remember one time one of my brothers came to meet me part way. And when I was 5, I had polio. I had the virus. I didn't get the paralysis, but my brother Gilbert had the paralysis, and he had braces on his legs, but he came to meet me halfway so this bully wouldn't bug me anymore. And to this day, we chuckled, and he passed away a few years ago, but we just kind of chuckled because we often thought, if, you know, did they sick the dogs on us? Because all of a sudden these two dogs were chasing us and we were running down the street, like, you know, just going, and the dogs were nipping at our heels and our ankles, and it wasn't a good day. And, but anyway, we survived it. But it wasn't too long after that my dad and mom decided that they were going to move us out to the country. So they moved us out to the country. It was a small town. It was called Pala Butte. And there was about probably 250 people, and that might be including the dogs and cats. I'm not sure of the population. It was a very small community, and it was after the war. It was during the, late 50s, and there was a lot of people that had survived the war and gone through hard times. And so we kind of became a little subculture within a culture. We were a town that banded together, and no matter what your culture or past or spirituality was, we did band together, and it was a fairly good life. Like, we, you know, nobody had a ton of money, but we were rich in other ways. You know, we had shelter, and my mom had a big garden, and, you know, things were going along good. And then I'm going to share with you just a little story on how sometimes things happen in life, and they kind of knock you for a loop. When I was 14, I lost my innocence, my childhood innocence. And it was a really tough time for me. I remember kind of living in a fog after that. And the sad, sad thing that I remember, and even to this day thinking back, is that when a young girl or boy or whoever is abused in such a way, you have to remember it. They can take your body, but they can't take your soul. They can't take they just can't take everything away from you. And like my friend Liz said, they can't take the light within you. And at that time, I didn't have all of that knowledge, but I do remember it was something that you're threatened that if you ever say anything, that things will happen. So you don't talk about it. You keep it, because all of a sudden it becomes your dirty little shameful secret. And that is so, so wrong. It is not your secret. It is not your shame. You did nothing wrong. If you're an innocent child, girl, boy, man, woman, whatever, if you're abused, it's not your dirty secret. That belongs to the person that did that to you, not to you. And so I think in my whole career, I have tried to focus on that when I have worked with youth or adult women or men, that if you've been abused in any way, you know, when you're a child and you're innocent, you have no control, no power over what others might do to you. But you can't let it define you. You at some point you have to rise up and say, okay, I'm going to make my way. But it did affect me in a lot of ways. It affected me for quite some time in my life. I feel that today, that it did affect me, because I always feel like what happens to you, and then you feel like you have the shame that you're hiding inside of you. So your self-worth is not as good as it could be. Your sense of identity is kind of, you wonder, what the heck is it? And so I don't think I had a very positive view of myself at that time, because in the 60s, I ended up an 18-year-old unwed mom. And my oldest brother was in the Navy in Halifax at the time. So he sent me a ticket, and off I went down to Halifax with my little baby, and saw the world, you know, that it was a harsh world. I remember going down there and thinking to myself, wow, like, he lived just outside of Halifax, and I'll share a story with you one day, something that happened to me. And I thought, wow, you know, it's not just discrimination against one group, but there's other groups that are discriminated against as well. My brother lived in Timberley, was just outside of Halifax. And I took the bus in town one day to meet him at the Lord Nelson Hotel when he got off work. And so I hopped on the bus, not thinking anything of it. And I didn't have my son with me. I had a really nice neighbor that was looking after him for me that day. And got on the bus and we drove along and we stopped at this one place that I later learned was Africville, just outside of Halifax. And so all these people got on the bus and I was not raised to look at people by their color. I was raised that people are people. And then that was the way it was. So all these people got on the bus and I never thought anything of it. When we got to Halifax, I wasn't too sure where I was supposed to get off to go meet my brother, and direction has never been my forte and it still isn't. So all these people, we stopped and there were shops and what have you. And I thought, well, this must be where I need to get off. So I got off the bus and I got off in at that time in Halifax, they called it the colored section of Halifax. I didn't know that. So then I'm walking along trying to find the Lord Nelson Hotel. And there happened to be a policeman on the one street. And he came up and asked me what I was doing there. And I told him. And I think he probably looked at me and thought, oh, my heavenly days. Here's this little hick from Palabute, Saskatchewan, you know. So he took me he walked with me and told me, okay, he said, when you cross the street, he said, then you're where you need to be. And he said, don't come down here again. And I've often thought of that, and I thought, you know, that's not right. That shouldn't be. We should be able to go anywhere. We should be able to walk at night. We should be able to walk early in the morning. We should feel safe within our community and any community. And sadly, the world hasn't really changed all that much over the years in that respect. You know, I do remember, you know, just other things. I remember being at friends' houses and seeing some of the draft dodgers coming up, just these young men that were coming up, and they were probably in their late teens, and they came up because they didn't want to have to go to war to shoot someone, and you had to respect that. But to have to come to Canada and never see their family again, and just, you know, I've lived a long time, can't believe how many decades I've been through, but I've seen a lot in my life. You know, I was born after the Second World War, so that gives you an idea of, you know, how young I am. But I've seen a lot. I've seen, you know, the discrimination, the racism in the early days of my childhood to what I witnessed in Halifax just different areas that I've lived in over my life. And because I've lived across Canada and many major cities But when I was in Halifax, and this will just kind of tell you how we need to help people, is that I did meet my husband, my first husband there, and had my beautiful daughter. But then we moved across Canada to Victoria. And it wasn't a very healthy marriage. It was a very... It was a negative marriage. It was a marriage that probably shouldn't have been. I think we were just too young. We didn't communicate. I didn't have a clue on life and the skills that you need that all these young children are learning now, which is so good, like finances and how to advocate for yourself and to find your voice. And I hadn't found that yet. But it was an abusive relationship. So that's how I ended up coming to Lethbridge. And I have been very thankful to be in Lethbridge. You know, I got here and I got a job as a waitress and I got a place in Lethbridge housing. And when I applied for Lethbridge housing, I didn't have any money because when I came here, I just had my kids and I in a couple of suitcases. And but I was really fortunate because Lethbridge Housing told me to go to income support. So I did, and I got help from them, and I offered to pay them back, but they said I was okay. So that was good. And, you know, we made do, you know, I learned a lot. And then I started going to school and I met people. And then for the last about 40 years, I worked in various areas in town here with, you know, different cultures and walks of life, and it's been really good for me, and this has become my home, and I feel really blessed now, and I know that in my work, when I worked in children's services and I specialized in domestic violence, and I did a lot of sexual assault investigations with the police, and I always felt that somehow my journey that I had gone through in my life took me to help me to be the best that I could be in my field, in my profession, in helping others. Because it's not to say that my skills were any better than anyone else's because I had experienced this, but I like to think that it helped me to have more empathy in knowing, you know, what happened was not, you know, you have to remember it's not your fault. Because I saw this time and time again, where even if it was a domestic or an abuse, that people always seem to take ownership of it, and it wasn't, and you can't, you shouldn't, you just, you can't. And people have, it's a healing journey. I know I have to share this with you. I was talking to someone the other day and I told them that it was probably about maybe 10, 12 years ago. I'm not sure. I can't remember. But I had carried a lot of this guilt with me over the years, with what had happened to me and my story. But one night I thought, you know, I need to forgive that person. I wasn't going to carry it with me anymore. So I got down and I prayed to God to forgive this person as well and to take them to heaven. And when I was done praying and I went to get up, I looked out of the corner of my eye towards my door. And it to me, and this is what I saw, and take from it what you will, but I saw this little black furry mass just kind of skitter along and disappear into the wall. And maybe it was a manifestation of all the negatives that were inside of me. I don't know. But I know that there's powers out there that we don't know about. So I'm not going to judge. But that's what I think. And I know when that happened, I felt such a calmness, such a sense of peace. And I do know. So I know that after my abuse, it was that sense of hopelessness and helplessness. And, you know, how many aspirin do you take from a bottle before you lay down and realize that, you know, you don't want to end your life. You want help. It's like a cry for help. So I think what my thing in life is, and my message to everyone, is that everybody is valuable. Everybody is worthwhile. And what you need to remember is that your body is your temple. You need to take care of it. Life is a journey. Life is a wonderful journey. You know, I don't think that we were put here to suffer and whatever. We need to be kinder to each other. We need to help each other. And that's what I have to say for that. And I've tried to do that in my work life, and I continue to do it as much as I can to help others. And I don't know if I'm forgetting anything. Liz, you pretty well know my life.
I think it's brilliant. And I think that's a brilliant, brilliant message.
You know, like, yes. your body is your temple. You know, I know there was times in my life that, you know, I treated it like a honky tonk, and because things happen and you just kind of abuse it because you don't think that you're worthwhile. But never think that, you know, you are worthwhile. So, I think that's about all I'm going to share today, except, you know, I do know that I come from a strong line of women that have done wonderful things in life, and my goal is sharing my story and the story of my ancestors and my parents. I just want to honor all of them, because, you know, they've made contributions to the world and helped in so many ways. But I want to show something to you, Liz. Pass the giant picture.
The giant picture, yes.
I wanted to share this with you before I you know, we do the question and answer. I don't know if you can see this or not. It's not, you can see the two men, and it's kind of hard to see. But the little short guy is my grandfather, Andre Gaudry, and the other one was Edward Boupre, and he was the Willabunch giant. And that's a whole other story that I could tell you, the story of how he came to be in the circus and my grandfather going with him. And then I also wanted to show, and I think probably maybe Liz, if you just hold that up in the back so that people can kind of have a look. This is the it's kind of hard to see. It's the Willow Bunch it's the homesteads in Willow Bunch, and they're all marked there. And my grandfather is up there. They had three lambs, different. There was a Mabel, Andre, and Mosey. And then there's Laguerre had a couple of far spots there. And it's wonderful to have that, because, you know, when you're settling, the best thing is to have water. You need to have that water. They had a lot of abundance of wildlife in that area, fish, berries, the willow. It was just an amazing place to grow up and raise children. Now I want to dazzle you with one last thing before I go. One of my oldest brothers passed away about 10 years ago. And just not too long ago, one of his daughters gave me a copy of the family tree on my father's side. There was a professor in Manitoba, one of the universities that is related to us, and he had done this. And so I just received this not too long ago. I haven't had an opportunity to look at it yet, but I am exploring my father's side. But wait till you have a look at the size of this genogram. I think it's about 10 feet long.
We need the Willow Bunch Giant.
Oh, yeah, we need the Willow Bunch Giant to hold it. Just going to move this here so you can kind of get a better idea. I'll hold this. Yeah, just in this, we'll just kind of pull it up and show you that it, and it goes even higher and higher and higher and higher. And then there's still about 4 feet down on the bottom. So it's going to be very, very interesting when I have a chance to go through that to see the generations of, I think that looks like it could be one city by itself. Anyway, I know I have a lot more stories, and if you know me, you know that I could talk for hours endlessly, but that's all I'm going to do today. If you do have any questions, or if you want further information or stories or whatever, just feel free to contact me and I will try to assist you as much as I can. And if you're also looking, if you think you have the potential to be registered as a Métis, our Métis community here, our Métis local is the place to go. And other than that, thank you so much for having me today. Thank you, Pam. Thank you, Amanda. I really do appreciate it.
Thank you, Louise. That was beautiful. Amanda, did you want to read the questions today?
Yes, I will be glad. I will be glad to do that. Can you hear me, Pam?
Oh, yeah, perfectly.
Okay. So, Naomi said, thank you so much for sharing, Louise. Your story is incredibly powerful, and I am grateful to be able to listen. There are parts that resonate with aspects of my own family, and hearing the similarities is an interesting experience. Am I correct in thinking that you are an elder with the local Métis Association? How can one connect further with you or people like you?
All right, well, I'm not an elder with the local Métis community. I am a grandparent elder at the college in the gathering space. And I'm also have been very honored with Sean and Travis to have been asked to be a Métis elder at the Sokotoki Friendship Center a few years ago. So I am there. And my email, if you want to connect with me, I can certainly will share my email, and please feel free to. And if you do want to connect with the Métis local, there, you know, just email me and I can give you the phone number and what have you.
We have another question from Tamara. What is the significance of the different colors of the Métis sash? Mine is like the ones you showed, and I've seen a variety of sashes and wondered why they are different.
Oh, those, I guess, two different colors.
Ah,
just one second. Now there's many different, I've got these two, which are different. I got these from Rupert's Land, and then we have the one that we wear here in Southern Alberta. And there's different symbolic colors, and I don't profess to know everything. I know that there is a lady at the Métis local that does know what the colors are. So maybe if you get a hold of them, she would be able to help you. Like I said, like I'm just learning my history and I don't want to make it up. So it's just not something that I've been more looking at the stories and how my ancestors came to be and exploring them. So there's people that are much more knowledgeable in that area than I am that can certainly help you.
Thanks, Louise. People are asking if we can provide Louise's email. Is that okay, Louise?
Yes, it is. Yes.
And your email is?
Oh, Sal, I think it's up there, isn't it, Pam? Do we have it? Saloff5@shaw.ca. There we go. There we go.
There we go. Now everyone can get a hold of you.
Yes, they can.
Well, I don't think we have too many other questions, but I just want to thank you, Louise, for sharing your story. And it's not easy to share your life story. And
no, but
I always like to learn more about the Métis and how we can connect with each other. So,
okay.
I'll just, if you have any last words, and then I just want to thank everybody for tuning in and listening to our Métis presentation. So
well,
please, I'll let you end it off.
All right. Well, I just want to say to everyone, thank you for joining in. And like I said, email me if you have any questions, and I will try to answer them. And if I don't know the answer, I can certainly forward you the links that you can find the answers. And just remember to be kind to yourself, be kind to each other. You know, life is a journey. Let's make it a good one. And now I'm looking forward to going to the Interfaith Food Bank this afternoon to be in the Bannock cook-off. So.
I think we may be competing, so.
Are we? Who are you with?
I'm with Tamara's team, so.
Who am I?
You better watch it.
That's who I'm with.
Oh, well, then we're on the same team. We're good.
Yeah, we are. And I've got some aprons I'm bringing with me. And I'm bringing
Liz. Oh, good, because I don't. Absolutely. Awesome. Pam, you should come over and.
Yes, you should. Yes.
Thank you. Louise, that was great. I really appreciate it. I enjoyed you telling us those different things that happened.
Well, thank you.
And your perspective on it, I really appreciate that.
Well, thank you. Thank you for having us.
Okay.
Bye, Louise.
Have a great day, and we'll see you, I guess, online at the Bannock Cook-Off.
You will. You will.
Okay.
Bye. Talk to you later. Okay, bye now.
Bye.